Hey guys, welcome to all of you on our channel, that is IAS. So friends, as you know that on our channel we are targeting the exam of civil services, and for that purpose we have started multiple series on our channel that target your prelims as well as mains. So in this video we will be talking about our mains answer writing series. So as you know, in our mains answer writing series, what we do, we daily give you questions of which you have to write the answers. So students were also demanding that please sir also provide the model answers of the questions which you provide, because it will help us in getting an idea about the demand of the question and how to write an answer. So considering that demand, we have decided that what we will do, we will daily upload one model answer relating to one question. So as it is difficult to discuss all the question answers here, so we will be discussing one answer so that you can get a rough idea about how to write mains answers and how to approach your answer. So today's question is about human animal conflict. So human animal conflict is an issue that demands urgent attention. Discuss the measures that can be taken to address this conflict. So friends, you might have heard in newspapers the mention of a human animal conflict, and you might have also come across various incidents in which this happens. So here you have to discuss about the measures that can be taken to address this conflict. So before starting, let me tell you friends that an important note that is provided here by us is that this is not a model answer. You are required to take it only as a reference source, because no answer in UPSC can be a model answer. But had that been the case, the toppers would have scored 100% marks, but they score in the range of 50 to 55%. That clearly shows that no answer can be a model answer as per the standards of UPSC, because each question has its positives and negatives. So friends, how to start this answering this question? So what you can do, first of all, you can define human animal conflict, that what does it mean, how you can describe it. So basically, human animal or wildlife conflict is basically interaction between wild animals and people, and its resultant negative impact on people and their resources, as well as on wild animals and their habitat. And it occurs when there are wildlife requirements which overlap with those of human population, and thus there is a kind of overlapping of requirements for resources, and this creates competition, and it costs both to the residents as well as wild animals. So it is in existence for long time. So friends, here you might say that introduction is going quite long, but let me tell you friends that here our purpose is to give you also an idea about the topic which we are discussing. It is not just you to it is not just to provide you a 200 word answer, because if in case we provide you 200 word answer, then approximately 60 to 70% will go in your mind, and you will be able to reproduce only 30 to 40%. So for that purpose we are ensuring a comprehensive coverage, but you are required to stick to word limit. And why we are crossing the word limit? Because so that you can have enough raw material for while you attempt the answer. So it is in existence, this human animal conflict is in existence as far as long as humans have existed, and they have started agriculture. So basically always human is also a kind of we can say an animal, and which is dependent upon nature, and also other animals are dependent upon nature. And when there is an overlap of the landscapes and resources, then this conflict arises. So basically now this has become a global phenomena in rural areas, and also it is making appearance in urban areas. So the main reason is basically increasing human population and increasing demand and increasing forest pressure on forest areas. So this conflict is also increasing, and also there is a kind of overlap of territories, of resources, resources, and this increases interaction and and the resultant conflict. So it is estimated that about daily it is not just a minor problem, but it has increased to an extent that about one person has been killed every day for the past 3 years by roaming tigers or rampaging elephants. So what could be the issues, reasons behind this human-animal conflict? So friends, there are multiple reasons behind. So before going into detail of those reasons, we must know that what type of conflict is there. So conflict is basically for space. So humans as well as wildlife animals, they compete for space with each other, and then there is crop raiding and destruction by wild animals, for example elephants or bears and other animals. And also then there is attack on livestock, on the livestock, and also injury or death of humans. So the contemporary science has revealed that these carnivores, these animals that are in wildlife, they the human being is not their traditional, or we can say their actual diet. But this being told, we cannot rule out the possibility of they not attacking the people, but because they attack people as well as damage their property. So crop raiding is an issue, and it has been in existence since the agriculture came into existence, because obviously human being cleared the land for the purpose of agriculture, and this this would have kind of we can say affected the landscape, and would have increased the competition between animal and human, but not to that extent in the past. So large mammals, they have huge ranges. Other things are that these large mammals, for example animals, they have huge ranges, and they continuously move on across their territory. So also other thing is that food is available easily in the form of crops. So they move close to these crops and damage them and eat them. So also it has been seen that radio colored elephants, they move from West Bengal to Assam and then back on a regular basis. So elephants, they don't reside in a single place. So if in case, for example, you have a reserve that protects animals, then it doesn't mean that elephant will not move out of that reserve, because elephants have the habit to move long distances. So migration from West Bengal, northern West Bengal to Assam is a common phenomena, and then this results in a frequent interaction, because you can protect the elephants in protected areas, but you can't protect them while they are moving in between these protected regions. So the main question is that why do animals raid crops? So, and also why do leopards or other animals attack livestock? So what is the main issue? So simple thing, first of all, we must focus on is that that World Database on Protected Areas 2012 found that only 13% of the earth surface belongs to global network of protected areas. So that means 87% of the earth surface is not protected area, and the species that are under threat, they are protected under just 13% of the landscape of earth. So this shows that there is a huge pressure, and obviously these protected areas are the last resort for many of these large and threatened mammals. So you must remember that obviously when the population is large of a particular animal, then certainly it can't be there in all population can't be there in the protected area, because some animals have the trait of maintaining their territory. So obviously a limited number of animals of a particular species can be accommodated by that particular protected area or territory for that matter. So obviously the others who will be at disadvantage will move out of that protected area. So only if 13% of the earth surface is the belongs to global network of protected areas, then obviously this becomes a last resort for many large and threatened mammals. And in fact when the population increases in itself creates burden on the ecosystem of that protected area, and it becomes unsustainable to sustain a large number of particular species. So they are basically, and these protected areas are in fact surrounded by human population.
Because agriculture is expanding, so people are cutting forests for the purpose of agriculture, and then livestock population is also increasing. So if livestock population is increasing, then obviously the burden on nature will increase. So obviously if livestock population increases, it feeds upon the herbs that are eaten by the other animals, herbivores that form the prey base of many carnivores. Then obviously there will be little that will be left for the purpose of herbivores, and when less food is available to them, and then their population decreases or they migrate, and when the prey population decreases, and then predator also suffers. So there are multiple issues, and then there is fragmentation of land because of this. As the developmental activity has taken place, infrastructure development has taken place, this has led to the fragmentation of habitats. So protected areas are there, and but they are fragmented and only small in their size in area. So in between these fragmented lands, there is no protection, and these animals who have tried to move from one region to other, for example the these elephants, then they come under with the direct conflict with the people residing in between these fragmented lands. So this conflict occurs, and it often takes tough situation. It happens under tough situations, and also the attack is propelled by people's way of trying to chase away the animal. And then also there is growing human population. So that is the common fact. You all people know that human population is growing, and obviously there is demand on resources, and also wildlife is also growing. So but the resources are limited. So when the resources are limited, so obviously there will be competition for resources, and this adversely affects both the species, both the human beings and these animals. And then there is transformation of forests, savanna, wetlands and other ecosystems into agricultural or urban areas. So in simple word, you can say that land use pattern has been changing. So there is a kind of land change in land use. So obviously this is because of the increasing demand for land is there, food production, energy, water and raw material is there, and this has led to dramatic loss of wildlife habitat. Because if there is a transformation of a forest into a agricultural land, then obviously the population that is dependent upon that ecosystem on that forest, that will suffer a loss because of the degradation in the habitat or a degradation in the overall ecosystem, as well as on the degradation of prey base and all those things. And then there is unsustainable development that is taking place. So the land is being put under pressure, and it is the pattern that is followed is unsustainable land use. And then also people are increasingly encroaching in country's traditional wild spaces. So elephants, for example, find their usual corridors blocked by railway tracks and factories, as I told you, in case of infrastructure development projects. And then there is a urbanization and growth agenda. So urbanization obviously increases the demand upon raw material, because urbanization when a civilization undergoes urbanization, its demand grows, and when its demand grows, it demands when the urbanization takes place, the specialization in different activities take place, and this specialization demand raw material, because obviously when the work is not limited to just agriculture, then they will be demanding different raw materials which can be extracted only by using land or by cutting forest and all those things. So this affects the overall development. And then there is also failure of government measures. These are main reasons also. For example, human wildlife conflict mitigation, the most of the measures in it are dysfunctional, haphazardly implemented, and therefore not effective. And also elephants travel to long distances, as I have told you, and most of those areas fall outside the protected areas. And also then there are territorial animals, so they do not have enough space within reserves, and also their prey is not there much because of the lack of availability of enough fodder to thrive on, because of the increase in livestock population. So other thing is that there are large number of animals and birds outside the notified protected areas. So wildlife experts say that approximately 29% of the tigers in India are outside the protected areas. And then they, through the developmental projects, for example, roads, railways, highways, there is not just fragmentation of land, but also there are issues of roadkill of wild animals, and it is emerging as a new enemy. So there is no proper land use planning, and there is no buffer zone between wildlife and human settlements. So resources are scarce, and human being is trying to extract the raw material or for other things that it needs from wherever possible. So there is a little buffer that exists between the wildlife and human settlements. So human settlements have been built very close to these wildlife areas. Obviously, when there is proximity between the wildlife and human settlements, the human wildlife conflict is bound to happen. So monkeys among urban areas, they are a common sight, and also then there is a continued destruction and divergence of forest land. So man-animal conflict in India is of many types. For example, you can see monkey menace in urban areas, then crop breeding takes place by ungulates, and then also there is a depredation thing that is done by elephants as well as cattle, and human killing by tigers and leopards. So there are many reasons for it. For example, this increase in man-animal conflict is like associated with kind of adaptability trait that is there in the animals. So they are adapting themselves to the new conditions. So obviously, when there is scarce food available in their areas, they will obviously move out, and they are, because adaptability is basically the trait of every animal. So they are adapting to in the face of the shrinking habitats, and they successfully come close to human habitation. And also other thing is that there is degradation of habitats, depletion of natural prey base, changing crop patterns, suitability of man modified habitats to wildlife animals, and the presence of stray dogs and cattle in the forest fringes areas. So if there is cattle in forest fringe areas, obviously if animals will come, and they will come to eat the cattle or, for example, the crop. So this increases the proximity between human beings and wildlife. So obviously, the crops like sugarcane tea estates are reported to provide excellent cover for wild animals. So these sugarcane and tea estates, they kind of provide camouflage to these animals, so they feel safe there. So how is India dealing with the man-animal conflict? So there are multiple approaches. For example, awareness program is there for the people, that is what to do and what don't, what is not, what the people should do and what should not be done by the people. So then there is training program for forest staff and police, and then there is Wildlife Protection Act. But the issue with Wildlife Protection Act is that when it was framed, the thinking was that the human interference causes adverse effect on wildlife population. So it was thought that a species can be protected only when humans are not brought into contact with these animals. So there was a focus on establishing human free zones. But today the population has increased to such an extent, and the demand has increased to such an extent, that there will be the interaction between humans and these wildlife animals is bound to happen. So in that context, this approach is faulty now, that is designating human free zones. So what we can do is we can educate and make people aware of how to deal with these situations, and also we should do monitoring so that we can prevent the potential conflict that can be there. So there is also then the technical and financial support is provided for the development of necessary infrastructure. For example, the fences, solar fences, and then boundary walls. So assistance to state government is provided, and also supplementing the efforts of state government is done by the central government. For example, the payment of ex gratia to the people for injuries and loss of life. And then there is also encouragement of the state governments to declare more areas as protected areas, so that the wildlife can be conserved effectively. And then there is eco development developmental activities that are taken in nearby villages around the protected area, so that the cooperation of the local people could be elicited in the management of these protected areas. Obviously, if there is human animal conflict, and if you are not addressing the human part of that conflict, then certainly this problem can't be eliminated. So for that purpose, it is necessary
necessary to aware to make aware people how to deal with this conflict and how they can coexist and coexist peacefully with these wildlife animals. So supporting involvement and research and of the research and academic institutions is provided, and then there is a use of technology, for example GPS, and then radio collars or satellite uplink facilities which monitor the movement of wildlife animals. So this monitoring can help in giving alerts to the local people so that the possible encounter can be eliminated. And then there are centrally sponsored schemes like Project Tiger, Project Elephant, and integrated development of wildlife habitats. So what should be done more? So measures that should be adopted must be that there should be a sea change in the shift. So the approach must change. There must be shift in the understanding of stakeholders. So all the stakeholders, whether policymakers, scientists, media, local people, they must be knowing that how to deal with these things. So obviously one thing is that only a few regions are protected. Say for example, in India only 4.87% of the total surface area is protected. So obviously all the wildlife animals, they can't be confined to these places. So what can be done in this context? So the main issue is awareness of the people, so that people can be made aware of these heavy risk areas, and those people who are residing in these heavy risk areas, they must be educated so that they can prevent or mitigate the conflicts. And also there must also be focus on monitoring system so that the communication with the people can take place, and information must be dispersed to them on such conflicts so that they can be prevented or mitigated. So live warning and monitoring system is the need of the hour, and also every effort should be made to promote the coexistence and prevent negative interactions, because you can't simply force people to move out of a particular region, because population has already increased and clearance of the forest areas has already happened, and people are it is very difficult to influence people to relocate to a new area. So better thing will be kind of relocating those people who are in very high risk area, and also building their capacity and capability so that they can positively deal with this conflict without affecting negatively to either human beings or animals. And then there must also be promotion of forest corridors, because forest corridors are necessary, and they must link protected areas so that the elephants or other animals can move, and the need is the involvement of the local community. So large carnivores also pose a challenge when it comes to conflict. So why they come close to human habitations? Obviously when the prey base is eroded. So one thing which the experts are suggesting is that developing the prey base or safeguarding the prey base. So what we can do is experts are suggesting that we can increase the population of wild ungulates, for example hares and wild boars. So they are prolific breeders and as a prey for wild carnivores. So if they can be kind of, we can say, reared in separate big enclosures, and when the population increases, the excess stock can be released in jungles at regular intervals for the purpose of wild carnivores to prey upon them. So that thing can help, because that will reduce the pressure on the nature and potential movement of the these carnivores out of their territories. And then there must also be focus upon draft national forest policy, so which is an overarching policy for forest management. So also there is a proposal for national community forest management mission. So that must be launched soon. So because community participation in forest management is necessary, and when community is involved, the conservation is effective and sustainable. And this can help because National Community Forest Management is a mission, is a kind of recognized practice in other countries also. So that must be launched. So friends, this is all about today's question. So as you can see, this question has consumed nearly 24 minutes. So obviously it is difficult to discuss all the three questions here. So if in case you liked the discussion, then you can join our daily Mains Answer Writing Initiative.
and you can get the model answer of all the three questions, the link of which is available is shown on your screen. So you can use this link to join our initiative. So this link will also be provided in the description box, so that you can use the link and can join our initiative. So what are the benefits? Benefits are basically daily three questions will be given to you, out of which two will be from your current topics and one will be from your static topic. So you will be getting comprehensive evaluation of your answers as well as valuable feedback, and also reference sources will be shared with you for all questions. And it is also least costly, so you can join on a monthly basis as well. So there is no need to pay full fee in the beginning itself. So you can join on monthly basis as well. So the link is here, which will be provided in the description box also. And lastly, friends, we also have a website that is www.achieveias.co.in, on which you can visit to see daily updates that we do regarding the UPSC CSE examination. And also, friends, you can join our Telegram channel, which is shown on here, the link of which is also shown here, and which the link of which will also be provided in the Telegram channel. So this is all about today's video. Do ensure that you like it, share it with your friends, and also ensure that you subscribe to our channel. So thank you very much. Have a very nice day ahead.